though Y was a noble lad like anyone else, always working to empower others, to give people the chance to do things they never knew they could. The Y was humble in its younger years, journeying through the land that time forgot. Wide-eyed and bushy-tailed, the Y had some snarl, playfully bantering with its mother while learning to walk. Nobody expected the Y to be anything, lost in a sea of mediocrity and relegated to the part of the room where no one went unless they were close to death anyway. Who cared what the Y had to say? The Y wasn't understood, because the Y didn't understand the way of the world. So the Y took a summer job one year, working for a smithy. But like any young person, the Y didn't care for the hard-pressed lifting of the tenured older workers. The Y was a free spirit. Oh, what a cute little rabbit boy, the Portland masses said. In a case of mistaken identity, the Y took the smithy job back after a year of respite. But just before the turn of the century, the Y exploded, strutting its stuff for the old boys, lifting the irons and working the fires like a person possessed. The Y found strength in passion. The Y realized the zen in hard work and giving. The blinding light of truth and empowerment, the Y was the talk of the Windy City. The Y fathered children in the mountains, and the Y fostered the dreams of people across the land. But sadly, as with any Shakespearean story, the Y also drew the attention of those that didn't understand the Y, those that didn't respect the Y. And with the passage of time, the Y changed, less loving, more irritable, less open, more secluded. The Y snapped at those it had so lovingly fostered. The Y was fevered under the pressure to feed the machine. As the PSI increased, the Y felt pain in his shoulders, having to haul the same bucket after bucket of words to the blazing inferno of the kiln. The Y became about earning instead of granting. The Y hoarded the little straws of opportunity for the fortunate, for the deserving. The Y didn't understand these changes. The Y was scared and angry at the same time. Slowly, unintentionally, the Y retreated from glory. The Y had changed so much that people started calling it the Who. Going to work, pounding the blazing hot metal harder and harder with the same worn tools, trying to fashion past glory into a new headpiece. Like some regretful alcoholic, the Who would look back on its former life from the gutter after work, having lost the luster and the sparkle of life, drowning in a sea of remorse, pulling on the pant leg of any passerby and saying, "I was a big shot in my day." The Who could not find the strength to change, slogging through the dry, dusty streets, old, worn out, with no passion or inspiration, clinging to its little tin bottle of hope. The tin bottle held an inscription. The Why is because everyone deserves a chance. The Who started having breathing problems and heart murmurs, and the Who became bitter, angry, shouting out curses and prideful boasts with each passing year. The Who lost more luster, more interest. Friends soon became acquaintances, became strangers. And finally, the Who was alone. The Who stared at itself in the mirror more than once, knowing that the gleaming silver blade on the bathroom sink could show the way out, could end the madness, could let the poison to the drain, and finally let the insanity end. And every time, the Who would turn away, finally settling in to its fate in a long, cold, lifeless dream of what had been.